Thank you very much. I am Michael Leonard. I'm vice president of ICAS and have been president of numerous ad hoc divisions. You know Secretary General Metsu-Reed. We wanted to talk to you about some new things that as international federations you may be reading about or hearing about. As people of sport, we also understand that we are in extra time, so we will try and do this quickly. But I think it's important, if you read about some of the things CAS is doing, you understand where it came from and how it affects you. So we'll start at the basics. CAS provides a specialized dispute resolution service to the Olympic and international sports world. Our goals are to provide swift, cost-effective, expert resolution of sport disputes, and we continue to evolve and change both our rules and our services based on two pillars: the recognized standards of international arbitration, as well as the needs of sport. So our evolution is driven by the needs of CAS to respond to the needs of the international federations, the IOC, the athletes, and the other stakeholders. Harkening back to what Thomas Bach said in the opening, we need to be innovative. We need to be innovative in response to what you request, because some of these requests are a little different and difficult. Having said that, one of the key examples is when we created the ad hoc doping divisions at major sports events. By the way, I'm doing the play-by-play. Matthew will do the color commentary. So we'll get to the meat of this, and he'll start to add in. So we handle, as you know, all of the appeals of doping decisions, among other things. We have been requested to provide some first instance doping hearings. In other words, we hear the appeals from first instance doping, and now we're being asked to help on the first instance doping. This has arisen in a number of contexts, and Matthew discussed some of them. Matthew, you can do it again, or I can, or?
I think we can go quickly on that.
Yeah.
It's part of what I said in the replacement of the Russian Athletics Federation. So we were, in fact, put in the arena already at the early stage to cover up what was missing. So the first instance national federation, and we replaced the Russian Federation as a first instance authority with all the difficulties that we could face concerning translation, concerning the presence of interpreters at the hearing, and but we worked through that, and it was in the end successful. We could handle these procedures in a fair manner, so the athletes could be represented, could attend also the hearings for those who wanted to be there. So the system worked, although we had little time to prepare.
The second one Matthew spoke about, the IOC requested that we provide the first instance doping hearings at the Olympic Games in Rio. This was to take the place of what used to be the hearing held by the IOC Disciplinary Commission. By the way, we'll speak more on each of these topics, but and afterwards, some of the international federations asked us to take an expanded role with respect to those first instance hearings during the Olympic Games, and that expanded role was traditionally, or always, the IF handles the sanctions part of the hearing against their athlete, and some of them said, we would like you to do it afterwards. We did not do that for Rio, we're considering it now. And thirdly, and briefly, we're being asked, why don't you do all of our international federation first instance doping hearings. So we're trying to be responsive, and there is a prima facie question the lawyers would ask, how can you be doing the appeals as well as doing the first instance? And we have a couple answers to that. One, we understand the issue, and you can't address a problem until you realize that it might be a problem. Second, this situation has occurred for quite a while in CAS in other ways. The Australian domestic system, which includes their first instance doping, they've adopted 100% of CAS. So when there's an Australian situation that is appealed to CAS, CAS arbitrators, not the same ones, but CAS arbitrators are ruling on something other CAS arbitrators have ruled on. In the United States, the requirement for the first instance doping is that any of the domestic arbitrators must also be CAS arbitrators. These are done to try and create harmonization in the application. And we've been able to deal with those and haven't seen any untoward effects. And third, as you'll see, in each of these scenarios, we have tried to put in safeguards to ensure that there's no untoward effect with a panel of CAS arbitrators potentially overruling another panel. So, first instance Russian, Matthew already talked about this, but he can summarize.
I think your chart covers mostly what I said,
right.
Namely also the possibility for the athlete to choose between a sole instance or a two-stage instances system. Yeah, I think we had, for the moment, just one appeal against CAS award rendered as a first instance, but we may have others. We don't know. It's a bit early to say.
The one thing I would highlight, which is interesting, is in the U.S. domestic system, they provided athletes with the same ability to skip the first instance and move directly to the appeals division. This is an issue that we on ICAS discuss all the time. From an athlete perspective, from a doping organization perspective, why should the athlete have to do it twice? Because remember, a CAS appeal is held de novo. So they will look, unlike a normal appellate court, they will look at all of the facts as if they saw it for the first time. Now, some people want to have those two cases. Some people say, one and done, I would like it over. We're aware of that issue, but we're trying to balance what different people want, which is why Matthew allowed in the Russian cases, you can come directly and have one hearing if you wish. Again, I'll let Matthew go through this because he handled some of it in his report.
So basically the ICAS got the request from the International Olympic Committee to organize a specific division or structure which would replace the IOC Disciplinary Commission to handle doping cases during the Olympic Games. So the jurisdiction for this CAS ADD, the Anti-Doping Division, is limited to the period of the Games, including the 10 days before the opening ceremony, where the athletes are already in the village under the jurisdiction of the IOC or the organizing committee of the Games. So because tests are performed also in the village during the Games, out of competition, and these cases were subject to further assessment by the IOC. What's the name again? It's the Medical and Scientific
Games Group.
Which is a structure inside the IOC. This commission or this group was in charge of deciding whether a case could be a case for CAS or not, whether there's an anti-doping rule violation, possibly a positive test or any other elements which would perhaps is which would be a signal for a possible disciplinary procedure. So this group was able to decide which case should be submitted to the CAS Anti-Doping Division, and then it was the beginning of our procedure.
Matthew described this. We put it in again only to show that to handle the prima facie question, we had a different structure for the ADD compared to the ad hoc division. I was the president of the ad hoc division, but we had different people involved in the Anti-Doping Division.
The interesting thing here is that the two people you see, the names you see on the screen, Carole Maninvo is an attorney in Paris. She's an expert in arbitration, international arbitration, is not connected to any sports organization. And Judge Eusebio is a federal judge in Switzerland, so also someone who is not linked to any sports organization. And they were in charge of appointing the different panels. or possibly to rule on any kind of provisional measures which would be requested by the IOC or by an athlete. So this is important to show also that it's an organization which works also with people who are not linked to any sports organization.
These are some issues with respect to the operation. Before Matthew goes, I'll point out one critically important thing, which is that the process starts when the Scientific and Medical Games Group provides or refers the file to the panel. One of the things that you might have read or in some of the things being said now, we are a dispute resolution process. We need somebody to dispute someone else. And we could create, and we talked to the IOC about creating an inquisitorial type process where we could receive merely the fact that there's a positive, let's say if it was, you know, positive doping, and then they say to us, what do you want to do? That's not how we've operated in the past, and it's not how we operated here, because the Scientific and Medical Games Group would actually be the charging party that would give us the, this person we think did an ADRV, we think they need to be provisionally suspended, and then the other person could say no, hence a dispute.
Can we talk about the procedure here?
Absolutely, yeah. Yes.
I think the important and interesting thing is to just briefly describe the procedure. When we get this request from the IOC Medicals and Scientific Games Group, then once the panel of arbitrator is constituted, normally it's a sole arbitrator because we had six people present who wanted to keep them available most of the time for future cases. So it's a single arbitrator dealing with the case. The goal was to be as quick as possible. It's the same as for the ad hoc division. So it means a good degree of preparation from the IOC, but also from the delegations, NOCs, and athletes. The goal was really to have a hearing as soon as possible after the case has been brought to CAS. So it needs a bit of a preparation before the game start. Of course, we have informed the different stakeholders of this new ADD. But the reason I'm saying that is that even if CAS is ready to act quickly, we need also the other participants to be ready and to have the same or almost the same degree of preparation. You can never expect that a case will come up during the games, but it's necessary to envisage this possibility. And maybe, or you say a word about the pro bono lawyers?
Yes, I was. If you are not familiar with the ad hoc division, which has been in operation for many games, we customarily will try to go into the Olympic City and have a bar association or some other group create a list of pro bono lawyers who are able to assist in not just the ad hoc, but this time the anti-doping. The process needs to work very quickly. And it only happens very quickly if they have learned counsel. But athletes don't bring their own lawyers. Many of the NOCs don't bring their own lawyers. Of course, the IOC and the IFs tend to have legal representation, but we would help foster this. We do not operate the program. We purposely don't do that, and we've been successful for many years in creating pools of arbitrators. We will actually fly down and teach a course in CAS and CAS jurisprudence and the ad hoc divisions to ensure that they're up and running. It was so well done in Rio that we now have other cities who have heard about it who are contacting us saying, I'm doing that in PyeongChang, I'm doing that in Tokyo, which is nice because this has taken on an almost institutional quality. Okay, interesting question. What is the difference if the ad hoc division hears doping cases and the anti-doping division hears doping cases? What's the difference? And how do you know which one to go to? As Matthew said, we had one case in the anti-doping division where a person was confused and notwithstanding an education, continued to want to push it in the wrong venue. In short, the reason I highlighted the importance of the scientific and Medical Games Group, is that if the jurisdiction of the Anti-Doping Division is based solely on what that group does at the games. That's it. But the way we described it in more colorful terms is, if it deals with a test tube at the games, that's the Anti-Doping Division. If it deals with an appeal from a piece of paper, let's say a regional doping decision in Egypt that happened within 10 days of opening ceremony, that's the ad hoc division. Met you?
Ma? It's okay.
Evolution of the Anti-Doping Division for future games. Right now, the IOC is writing the anti-doping rules for the IOC. As you heard, WADA is not involved except as an observer there. So these are IOC rules. We are working with them in certain aspects of the rules. The reason we are, they're not the substantive rules, but we want to make certain that their rules can plug into a judicial system, our tribunal, in a way that there's no misunderstandings and it's a smooth process. We also have received requests from international federations.
Yeah, this is important because it's a change compared to Rio. We will have, for the first time, the international federations involved in the procedure from the beginning. It means that once we have a case reported, we would inform the IF concerned of the existence of that case so that they can also participate in the procedure as a co-applicant or co-claimant, and then they would participate in the entire process, attend the hearing, and possibly, we're still working on that, but possibly also decide the real sanction later, because what we did in Rio was to decide whether an athlete should be provisionally suspended and then excluded from the games. It's only the IOC sanction, but if we have also the IFs on board, we may also decide on potential suspensions if the athlete is found guilty. And this would save at least one instance, because normally the procedure was that once the case is decided by the IOC and by CAS, then the case would be reported or transferred to the international federation concerned, and this federation would have to organize its own procedure, its own hearing, and finally issue its own decision, which can still be the object of a further appeal at CAS. So the goal was, rather than to separate both procedures, to gather it and to have everything dealt with by the same panel of arbitrators.
And two things to add. So in case we have people here who aren't so familiar with doping, there's the exclusion from the competition you're in, the Olympic Games or the disqualification, and the sanction is, and you are banned for 2 more years. Those are two very different things. Not all IFs want to have CAS decide the sanction. Some really do. So we will build in an opt-in so that the IFs who want to do that can do it, and the IFs who want to continue to handle their sanctions for their athletes going forward will continue to do that as well.
We have the support for all winter from all winter federations. So for PyeongChang, we will have this system in place. What I should say is that it's probably impossible for us to deal with all questions, all issues during the period of the games, because it's 17 days, or for us it's 27 days. But possibly when we have to decide about the sanction, the suspension, we may have to do that after the end of the game, so that the athlete or the parties in general have time to prepare, maybe to retain legal advice, a legal representative, and have legal advice before discussing this important question.
So or the, the experts who come in to say this is consistent with no substantial fault, things like that. They can't do that during the games. It's impossible. We also are discussing some other more technical issues that were raised in our analysis of what happened in Rio and in feedback from our anti-doping division arbitrators. So for example, the one of the things is, does the panel have to be involved if the athlete receives the notice that you are being suspended and excluded from the games, and the athlete never says, I want to fight that? Does the panel have to be involved? Under the rules as written, the panel had to be called and they had to do it. there are good arguments on each side. The panel serves a function to double check what that the prima facie case is made. But on the other hand, if there's no dispute, and athletes many times during the games would rather just leave and then fight the sanction afterwards, partly due to the press and other things. So we're going to be working on that. Also, clarification with respect to the panel's powers. Matthew said to not find an ADRV, not find a violation, and just focus on the suspension or expulsion from the games, because there are consequences under the WADA code when you find a violation. And maybe they needed scientific advice or expert witnesses, and they're not in a position to do that. We currently did have some tribunals, some panels, well, sole arbitrators, as Matthew said, who did that, but they were not comfortable necessarily that they had the full scope of those powers. And in that case, that the panel would retain the right to hear the ADRV case after the games, which of course dovetails nicely with the potential right, if the IFs want, of the panel to decide the sanction as well. The creation of a permanent CAS doping division. There's a lot of discussion of what's going on with WADA, how things will change to make them stronger, more robust, their new policies. And there is a discussion of CAS should have a permanent doping division to handle first instance cases. There are a number of issues that come with that. Again, if the IFs and sport asks us, we will look at it and determine how we might service their needs. So Matthew can go through the requests.
The third evolution, which is rather for 2020 probably, where we could have, if the federations are interested, of course, this CAS ADD operating also outside the period of the games, so at any time. If, for example, some federations would like to avoid having this kind of disputes handled internally, this could be delegated to an independent authority outside the federation, which would be the first instance. So it could be the CAS. And we are now studying this possibility of having probably a new group of arbitrators, because we think that it's impossible to mix or to have the same list of arbitrators operating in both divisions. So possibly and certainly there should be two different populations of arbitrators, so one for the anti-doping first instance and one for the appeals division. Well, discussion may be, but it's still also a discussion between ourselves, whether, for example, an arbitrator dealing with football matters could be also dealing with doping cases first instance, because there is no connection. But parties may sometimes be similar, so we need to be careful. I think, personally, I would prefer to be more prudent and to secure this aspect, knowing that CAS would be, would cover these two divisions. So the name Court of Arbitration for Sport would be the same for both divisions. So we need to ensure that we have different procedure, different people, and different set of rules applicable for these two type of procedures. So that's music for the future, but we think there's a strong interest. We have heard the IOC president. I think some international federations have already expressed their interest for that, and we will be working with our new rules probably during the year.
So, just to summarize, and why we thought it was important, one, to do this here because of the international federations, but also following WADA. In one sense, doing the first instance hearings is not new to us, because of the situation in the US and in Australia where CAS arbitrators are used in that function and appeals can be made to CAS. We also have an ordinary arbitration division, but they don't do the doping. On the other hand, there's many comments now about CAS should do first instance. Hopefully now you understand when you hear those comments in the press or by other people, these are the examples of the first instance that people are talking to us about or they're requesting services for, that we've already done, Russian track and field, that we did in Rio, we'll continue to do in other games, and we might offer, it's just an offer, to the federations in general. So that's the world of first instance doping from our perspective and where it stands. We can take questions. We can have Julian come up and we can, yeah, and take any questions.
And we still have 30 minutes to go.
Yeah.
And I also take question on other topic, if you want.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. On anything with WADA or anything for us. Yes.
Ah, okay. Absolutely.
Thank you. I'll ask each panel one question, and I'll save my 998 other questions to later. Very quickly, concerning WADA, you said, Julian, that you guarantee confidentiality. I want to get back to that on two aspects. First of all, what do you do with false whistleblowing? Do you press charges, first of all? Things also need to be looked at on the other side. And second thing, what do you do with obstruction of justice? If you find any very important evidence, what do you do by in handling criminal law in different countries, including the US, France, Germany, and all these countries, who would perhaps challenge the fact that you had information which you haven't shared or you didn't share with them? Mm-hmm. That's the first question. I'll ask the second one. It's a very quick one.
There were already two, but it's okay.
All right, so there's three questions. I was always bad in math. The very quick question concerning any conflict between ADD and AHD, assuming we started proceedings with AHD and then we find a doping issue, would that create any conflict between these two specific jurisdictions and two specific systems, or vice versa? Do we need to think about that, or is it settled in your approach? Thank you.
I'll go first, so I can take the last, and then.
Sorry,
Julian,
I don't know if I'm
Julian's
not clear.
Julian's questions are much bigger to answer, so and interesting. To me, the jurisdiction, I of course defer to my Secretary General. It's very clear that there's no overlap in jurisdiction between them. Again, we were very careful in working with the IOC in making certain that if it comes from the scientific medical games group, which means they have a test tube, or I'm being facetious. I mean, there's other ways to have a potential violation, but if it comes from them, it's the ADD. The soft conflict, if you will, was the prima facie question, which is, how will CAS arbitrators feel about potentially overruling other CAS arbitrators? Yeah. In our experience, and this is why I said prima facie question for lawyers, in our experience in Australia, in the United States, in other cases, they have no problem overruling each other, okay? None. And with the prophylactic that Matthew said, by having two different divisions, we think that will help too. But I defer to Matthew on answering those.
I agree.
They're lawyers, right? They like the the tussle. And the rest are for Julian. I can't answer. Matthew and I can't.
So let's start with whistleblowing. In the policy, it's written that if you provide false information and you submit it. Obviously, if you're not submitted to the jurisdiction of any anti-doping organization, it does not apply, but an athlete that is deliberately, intentionally providing false information via the whistleblowing system could be reported to his national, to his anti-doping organization and sanctioned for tampering, for example, for providing false information. So, and honestly, if you know our chief investigator, is not, on the en français, he's not born from the last rain, so he's absolutely capable of saying who, what information could be good or not. As regards the law enforcement, it's true that obviously if we have a request coming from law enforcement, from criminal justice country, it could be a problem. I think, and that it is in there that the law shall prevail, but we will also have to check on a case-by-case basis who is asking what and why. Obviously, if we have a Russian whistleblower and we ask by the Russian criminal justice, it will be a different guarantee that, I mean, say it's not to hit always on Russia, but I mean, it will have to be assessed. But obviously, it could be a problem, but I think WADA will defend itself and the whistleblower on the basis of this consent, but if there is really a law order, we'll see. But how to say that? It should be analyzed on each different jurisdiction and on a case-by-case basis. And yes. On CAS, new doping division, I'm looking at my colleague Ben Cohen, the director of Lausanne office there, because this would be the consequence of the discussion on this international testing agency. Which would be obviously not only testing, because it will be doing result management, TUE and many things, but is part of the group and of discussion on that. Correct me if I'm wrong, there will be a discussion, a report to our board in May on that topic. So I'm not part of this group. I don't know what the discussions are. So I will make two points that are only me and not WADA, because I don't know where we always this. But I, as a lawyer, would have two concerns. The first one is, as you mentioned, what's the, in terms of athletes' trust, to have the same organization dealing with my first case and my appeal case, is it good for athletes? Because I must say, we always look at everything under the angle of the athlete's rights, so what would be the athlete's perception on that? But this is, again, my view. And then, sorry, I would say something bad, but CAS was created to be always cost-effective and fast, and recently it has not been, it's become, and I'm sure there's valid reason for that, but has become quite expensive and sometimes quite a bit slow in some cases to render a decision. So if everything works well in first instance, I think, but this is also an element I would take into account, it has to be quite fast. But it was not to provoke any particular reaction. That's just 2 points like that.
Yeah, I think you're right. We are still cost-effective and quick. The fact is that parties sometimes prefer to bring an army of lawyers at CAS hearings. This is expensive for the parties, not for CAS. And also, they are happy to complicate the procedure sometimes when we are quick. The procedure also is quite strict regarding time limits. We can still extend this time limit with when the parties request that. So we are at the service of the parties. So when we hear cases take too long, we should think that maybe it's not CAS which is slow, but the procedure itself was slowed down because the lawyers could not comply with the time limits. Regarding the costs, of course, we try to offer these procedures free of charge. The goal is not to add another obstacle to access the CAS justice. So the proposal is to have funding for these procedures, so the ADD procedures, and we hope that it works. And we should see also regarding the problem of independence between the ADD and the classic CAS. What is the difference between now and the future? If the CAS ADD is created, it is to replace the internal committees or commissions of the international federations. And the question is to the athlete, do you prefer also to go before the international federation, or do you prefer to go directly before CAS and have two instances at CAS? So I don't think it's a big problem to switch between the IF and CAS for the first instance, knowing that CAS would still have an appeal. I mean, there's still an appeal procedure. And after CAS, there's still a review possible by the Swiss Federal Tribunal. So there's a control of the procedure at the end, which may be made by the Swiss Federal Tribunal.
Well, and I would just add, we are constantly concerned about the length of the proceedings. And when I say we, you know, the Secretariat, the ICAS, and we look at ones that are quite long. And a lot of the problems is the party's request and the other party acquiesces to delays in the proceedings. So we actually have tried to break out how much of this is our fault and how much of this is the parties, their lawyers couldn't meet and they're being collegial and it gets delayed for a month. So we try to keep track of that. And that's not to cast blame. The thing about the two hearings is conceptually very interesting. So I believe a hallmark of CAS that must remain on the appeals is that we hear the cases de novo. And if you think that, this leads to certain conclusions. The reason I think that is because on a number, on virtually every appeal that we hear that is then taken to the Swiss Federal Tribunal, the parties going to the SFT always say, my initial hearing was unfair, it did not comport with due process, I did not have a fair opportunity. And invariably, the SFT will say, that may be, but you had a de novo hearing at CAS, and we think that comported. So if we do think de novo hearings are important, the question to athletes is, why do you want to go through it twice? And I think that's a fair question, but it stems from the fact, I think you need de novo. If we were a true appellate court and didn't review all the facts, that's a different system. And we have athletes and groups who want to go twice, and they want the option to go once. And this, we're working on a system flexible enough to answer those questions, like Matthew did with the Russians sitting in for the track and field. Do you want one or do you want two? Like the US had for a while, do you want to go directly or do you want to have an initial? But we can't change the de novo. Long answer, but it's a critically important concept.
If I can add something, the de novo is key. This is no change to be done. As regards the code, the World Anti-Doping Code is saying that first instance, you need an impartial hearing panel. Second instance, impartial and independent. And we had this reviewed by the Judge Costa, independent, of course, the chair of the Human Rights Court in Strasbourg for years. And he said that if there's one independent instance in the chain, that is, in his opinion, sufficient. So I think this is why what we have this is the focus there. Then is this independent from the anti-doping organization that had initially the result management? Is it independent from the first instance? But I think whatever interpretation people give, this in any case, this is key to ensure that that the second level is independent from the first one, whatever at CAS or in any other system.
Mark.
Well, I have a little question regarding the whistleblower program. What about the role of lawyers and attorney at laws, respectively? I can imagine that athletes would like to stay in the back and hand over or pass on information only through a lawyer with a valid, power of attorney. Are there any requirements, or is it business as usual? Because we are talking about sensitive issues. Probably somebody would like to negotiate his or her whistleblower agreement through a lawyer, which is very understandable. Or in other words, how many people from these 80 potential whistleblowers approached you via a lawyer or an attorney at law? It's kind of protected whistleblower or something like that.
So to start with your second question, I have absolutely no idea, because the rule is that it's totally separated from the rest of WADA. So I have been told that the system works and that there is a lot, and this is the number I got. But this is, I cannot tell you who, when, and what, if it's through lawyers or not. Obviously, if an athlete willing to blow the whistle and is contacted WADA through the system wants to be represented with a lawyer, obviously, I can imagine it's possible. We have no example to date. It started, the application was launched mid-March, but obviously this should be absolutely possible. And once there's a standard whistleblower agreement that has been developed, but again, I can understand that any contract is negotiable. And,
okay, Steve, do you want to come up and say your farewell? You do it so well. Okay. Well, thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed this. We do think that that LawAccord is an important component of SportAccord, an opportunity to meet with the federations, to hear from WADA, to hear from CAS, and a few other interesting issues that can come up. So hopefully you find it equally important and interesting. Thank you very much for coming.